A SNP is a single letter change in our genetic code. So our genome is made up of four letters, which are called A, T, C, and G. And when you have a SNP, there's a change in one letter to another. So for example, you could have a mutation where an A would turn into a G, so that some individuals would have a G and others would have the A. So you get variation at that site in the genome. So a nonsense SNP is when the mutation causes a disruption in the protein. So it causes a premature stop to the reading of the protein, so that some individuals will have the normal active version of the gene, whereas others might have the inactive, truncated, or even lost version of the gene. We tend to think that adaptation will be achieved by genes that are somehow better. So that genes that have been disrupted or even lost, we tend to think that must be bad and a harmful thing for you. However, there are known examples from the literature that we've seen where losing a gene has actually been beneficial for the individual carrying it. So we decided to do a whole overall scan of these kind of things, and we looked at nonsense SNPs as a type of gene loss. And so we scanned all the available nonsense SNPs in the genome in a set of 1,200 individuals from populations around the world. For 99 of these genes, both copies could be lost in these individuals that actually seem to be living a normal, healthy existence. So when you think about the fact that the genome contains roughly 20,000 genes, this means that roughly 1 in 200 is possibly just dispensable from the genome. It doesn't really matter for us to lose those genes. We actually saw that Greg Venter has three times more inactivating variants than the average human in our samples. And you might take this to mean that there's a whole lot of nonsense going on in Craig, but that's not necessarily the case. But the fact of the matter is that his genome, in his case, his whole genome was sequenced, which would give you a much more in-depth view of the variants in his genome, whereas ours are only based from the databases, which are kind of sketchy and just distributed across the genome. So actually, we expect that for our nonsense SNPs, all of the estimates that we do are lower bound estimates. So no, it's not surprising that he had a higher number. So actually, in general, the nonsense SNPs that are known in the databases and the ones that we use in the study are only just the tip of the iceberg. And this will be changed a lot when new sequencing studies become available. When they're getting better and, more importantly, maybe cheaper, that this will lead us to discover much more variants, and especially rare variants. So we'll definitely find a whole lot of a higher number of nonsense SNPs in the human genome, actually, when we get these sequencing studies through. So in medical genetics, people are looking for disease-causing mutations. And when they come across a mutation like this, these nonsense SNPs, which actually disrupt or even, you know, completely inactivate the gene, they might really tend to hang on to the idea that this must be a harmful disease mutation. However, in this genome-wide survey of ours, we've shown that actually some of them can be lost in healthy individuals without any obvious consequences. So in those type of studies, in these kind of new personalized medicine and medical sequencing, it might be worth at least excluding these ones that don't seem to be having any effect on the individual's health. We find that there are certain types of genes that seem to be lost from our genome. And in fact, we found quite a high number of ones that are involved in our sense of smell. So it's possible to kind of consider the fact that in early times, humans didn't like smelly partners, so that when humans started living in bigger groups, it was advantageous and perhaps the only way to find true love that you couldn't really smell, you know, your partner. But that's, of course, a very wild speculation.